Welcome, everybody. Great to have you out on this snowy morning. No?
Yes?
All right. Very good. Great to be here in the house of the Lord this morning. We come here to worship the Lord. Amen? And I just encourage you, whatever burdens you might be carrying, don't walk out the same way you walked in. Just let them go. You know, that's the beautiful thing. When we worship the Lord and we sing, it's like a release of our spirit. And God knows what we're going through, what we're dealing with, and He just wants to bless us this morning, and He will. Let's all stand. And for those who are visiting for the first time, you've come here, welcome. Great to have you join us. Heavenly Father, thank you that we have a warm, comfortable place to gather this morning. We know that's not the situation around the world, so we do feel very blessed here this morning. I just pray that you would bless this message, the first message, Lord, as we advance towards Christmas and Advent, the first four Sundays leading up to it, the message of hope that Pastor Dave brings. I know that the world needs to hear this, and Lord, as this message is broadcast around the world, I just pray that you will just touch the lives of people that aren't here in person. God, when we walk from here today, we will truly be able to say it has been good to gather together in the name of Jesus.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Worship team.
Which one's that handle? It's not 17.
Let's mark this handle.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Nice to see that you made it out on this snowy day.
Oh.
You had extra time to clean off the car or shovel the driveway, but you made it here, so we are so happy to see you. As the pastor said, we are starting 4 weeks of Advent. And does anybody know what Advent means? It's Latin for coming. And it's a season of preparation for His arrival. And today Pastor Dave is going to be talking about hope. And I was thinking, if hope was an acronym, what would it stand for? And of course, I went on Google and had a little look there. What could it stand? What it stands for, and could be have only positive expectations. That could be hope. Or hold on, pain ends. That could be hope. But today we're going to focus on who the hope of the nation is, and that's Jesus.
Amen.
And in this season, more than ever, people need hope. And if we had as many people sharing scripture and hope on social media as we do people sharing all the other worldly things, I think it would be a happier world. And we are the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world, but we are salt and light in this world, and that's who God has called us to be. So we are going to sing a song called Jesus, Hope of the Nations. It might be a little bit new for some of you, but we hope you will pick it up and sing along with us.
Jesus, come for all who mourn. You are the source.
joy in the house of the Lord. So hope and joy go together, don't they? Because it's hard to be joyful if you have no hope. So we are going to go back and we're going to sing this song. Hopefully you'll sing it along with us.
Thank you.
said it actually is a song of hope. We're going to finish this one with it as well.
Peace like a river.
message behind that. Horatio, I think the author, lost his wife, I don't know, two or three daughters, I don't remember the story that well, but the theology is so rich in preparing our hearts for the message today that Pastor Dave is going to bring on hope. Well, we want to welcome everybody this morning. We do have Sunday school, and I believe, who's leading Sunday school this morning?
Janice.
All right, so if those want to follow Janice up to the Sunday school, we have some visitors here with some young children. Parents, you can sit in there if you want to, for the kids to settle in. And yeah, very good. Sunday school is growing, and so is our youth group. Amen. And our youth are working on a plan to get some youth activities going too, young adults and college and career age people. So be in prayer about that, by the way. You know, the direction. There's a lot of stuff going on in the world here today. We're just trying to find our way to navigate around it. A number of announcements here. Let's also keep Edna short in prayer. Just got a message that the family decided to pull the life support. She's only being kept alive through mechanical means, and the family just decided that her wish was to also not prolong. So, I don't know. I tried to get in touch this morning. She's still actually living, but be with in prayer with Nick. Nick has been faithful here over the years and taking care of Edna. You know, if you don't know them, they're Newfies. They're wonderful people. I just love people from Newfoundland. Their sense of humor. They've helped us get through times where we had hardships when we were in Africa for many years. We worked with some Newfoundland people, Newfies, and their jokes and how they just roll with it. And to listen to Nick as well, but Nick, for the last, I don't know how long, it's been a long, long time, would sing to his wife, and she would fall asleep. And the desire was that she would be released from heaven so she could be at home with her husband and fall asleep to his singing. And that's just looking like it's coming to an end, you know? So just keep Nick and the family in prayer. God's will, that's what we're just praying. We don't always know what God's will is. But we do know that God's will is the best. Even if we don't understand it, that's the hope. And I just encourage you to never give up on the hope of God. A number of announcements here. We do have some hard copies printed off. We don't print off too many because many people receive it by email. If you want to get on the email list, the announcements will be sent to you during the week. Then you know what activities are going on. Some are monthly, some are weekly. We have lots of things here. Men's prayer and ladies' meetings on Tuesday morning. Come on out. If you need prayer, if you can make that commitment, it might be a bit of a sacrifice, but God honors sacrifice. And I encourage you to do that. FM 90.7, for those who are listening out in the parking lot, you're welcome to do that. We have Facebook Live, and we record our messages later and put it on the church webpage. I got a message this week from somebody I'll probably never meet, but they listen in from Nigeria. And Nigeria is recognized today as the country that persecutes Christians more than any other country. And in the north there, I have friends in Africa that keep me updated what's going on there. And so when I look at how comfortable we are, sometimes we do take it for granted. We don't need to be feeling guilty about this. God has blessed us. The forefathers' work that has gone on to develop where we are today, even though it's being dismantled systematically today, God is in control. It's all part of the prophetic word of God. And as I hold up this prophetic word of God, this is a very special Bible. It's a study Bible. It's called the Fire Bible. And half of its content is study notes under the scriptures, certain key verses. They're selling for $40. We're not making any money on it, but we want to get that out. There's children's versions for $35. And it's great for parents to sit down with some of the pictures and the reading and the notes. So I really recommend this. I really recommend that people invest in getting the study Bible. Come and see us in the office or during the week after if you'd like. And I don't know if there's any other specific announcements at this time. We have an upcoming Christmas banquet. It needs to be, we have a maximum of 100 people. So sign up because after that we have to cut it off. And the library. We have a phenomenal library, and instead of just staying at home, why don't you come in, turn the fireplace on, and just read, and put the book back on the shelf, or take it home, bring it back here and read if you want a quiet place to read. But we've got books on all sorts of issues there, that personals, people, accounts, theology, all sorts of things. So I encourage you to use the library. It's just down the hallway here at the end. Go and visit it after the service if you would today. I think, I just want to thank the people, actually. We're going through a lot of difficulties today. So thank you for wearing the masks. These are much easier to sing with. They're made available at the back there if you don't have them or if you want to get them. Much easier than just putting a mask on. But thank you for not causing problems. I met with a whole group of pastors this week from all over, and some of their congregations caused them a lot of grief. And I just said, well, I just feel so blessed because I have a congregation of people with so many diverse opinions about what's going on, but we're getting along as best as we can. Amen?
Amen.
That's really important. So let's continue to do that. How many people here would say, honestly, you're a little weary? I'm putting my hand up because I'm in that category. I'm weary, okay? Look around. We're all weary. There's so many reasons why we are weary. But I want to share with you Isaiah quickly, 50 verse 4. It says, God's word sustains the worry. People, get into God's word. Turn the news off. Turn whatever else you're listening to. And if you're listening to more of that than the Word of God, I'm just encouraging you as a pastor, get into the Word of God. These study Bibles are excellent because the notes that will help you to understand the prophetic Word of God, that actually what's taking place today is no secret. God has already spoken of these things. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, and Jesus is saying simply to us, come to me, and we come to Christ through his Word. That's how we come to Christ. He's just basking in the presence of God's word. Galatians 6:9 says, don't be weary. In proper time, we will see that Jesus is going to keep his word as he's prophesying. It's all under his control. There's nothing going on in this world that God isn't in control over. And you just have to trust God's word on it. That's what faith is all about. You either are people of faith or you're not. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 3. Consider the sinful opposition that is going on and how many people in the past, when you read in the Bible, and like I'm saying today, the persecution that's going on, not just in Nigeria, but around the world, people are holding on to their faith right to the end because they know that this world has really nothing to offer that's worth dying for. But Jesus Christ, absolutely. Absolutely. His promise is amen. And then Revelation 2, verse 3, it says, persevere in times of hardship. Going through hardship. That's why many of us are weary. Don't give up. If you're listening on live stream or later record, wherever you are in the world, don't give up. And our hearts are with those who are in Nigeria and around the world where you're being persecuted simply because you simply just believe in Jesus Christ. I mean, what is there to fault about Jesus Christ? He gave his life for everybody. So that's why we follow that example of Jesus Christ. And lastly, Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. This is to commend us all as we navigate through different personalities and opinions about what's going on in the world. Do nothing from selfish ambition or empty conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourself. That's how we resemble the likeness of Christ. Let us do that. Let us not bicker, complain, grumble. Let us love one another, respect one another, treat others more highly than we treat ourselves. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Pastor Dave, come and challenge us from the word this morning.
Thank you, Pastor Glenn. Hope is faith holding out his hand in the dark. How's your soul faring today? I just sang that song, It Is Well. It is well with my soul. I love that line that says, my sin not in part, but in whole, has been nailed to the cross. It's not mine anymore. It is well with our soul. Amen. Amen. Well, it is the first Sunday in Advent today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this season that's upcoming. Thank you, God, that it points to world, the light of heaven coming to be with us. Lord, I pray that this be an incredible season of hope in every person in this place, that we would be filled with hope. Lord, we need it. The news all around us is depressing, absolutely depressing. But Lord, in you, there is hope.
Amen.
And that's what we want to look at today. Amen. Amen. So this is the first Sunday in Advent, and that isn't really a word we hear too much about in Pentecostal churches. We sort of left that up to the Anglican folks and the Catholic folks. And, you know, churches that have more of a different setting than we do. But I'm thinking we could be missing on something. And maybe some of you just Advent as, you know, that calendar where you get the chocolates. That's cool, too. I mean, I like that idea. But I think there's a little more to it than just that. So what is Advent? Well, it's simply the beginning of a four-week season leading up to Christmas. That's all Advent is. And it's got some traditions. It's got some rituals. It's got lighting of candles. It's got themed messages and that sort of stuff. And the word Advent just means arrival or coming. And we often speak of Christ's first Advent, right, as his first coming, and the second Advent as his second coming, which we are looking forward to with much anticipation. Therefore, Advent, this season we're coming into, is much more than just marking a 2,000-year event in history. We have to know that. It's much more than that. Yes, it looks back, but we need to look forward. So what I want to focus on today is, which is the first Sunday of the Advent season, this is Advent number one, is what does this period of time before Christmas, we've got 4 weeks till Christmas, what does it stir within us? Well, our pastor's message last week was entitled, What's Really Happening? And when he told me the title on Thursday, I thought, what is really happening? It's a question, but it's also a statement in itself, isn't it? What is really happening? I mean, if you've been living on a desert island and you've just come back, fine, you might not know, but if you're not, you need to know that there is a growing darkness, there is a growing evil in this world that not just Christians, but I know non-Christians also feel and know that if they're truly honest with themselves, there is a growing darkness, there's an evil that is coming upon this world. Maybe you haven't noticed enough, but I saw Christmas lights and Christmas trees going up at the end of October. I've never seen people putting Christmas lights out so early. Why is that? Because even to the non-Christians, there's something about Christmas that brings a sense of hope in people. And so they can't wait to put up the Christmas tree. They can't wait to put up the Christmas lights. Because once they see those lights, it's like hope is coming. There's something coming. And that is really what this Advent season speaks to our hearts. Both Christians and non-Christians, it's a season of hope. Something joyful is coming. There is a desire with anticipation. There's an expectation with confidence. So that's what it is. Brothers and sisters, just as our pastor says, if you're looking to the evening news for encouragement, ain't going to happen. Satan is the lord of the airwaves. All the stuff you are hearing, you need to be careful of what you're listening to. And as we get challenged every Sunday, get into the book, because that's where you will get the confidence and the strength. There isn't much hope that's being presented to you. When people don't have hope, they become what? They become hopeless. Proverbs 13:12 says, hope deferred makes what? The heart sick. The heart sick. A sick heart is a heart with no hope. A recent poll showed that Canada, this nation of Canada, was the second best nation on the planet to live in. It's pretty cool. I think the first was Germany. So we're going to have to work a little harder. But we're the second best nation of this world to live in. Yet every day across this country, at least 11 people commit suicide. 4,000 a year. Now listen to this. Among people aged 16 to 24, suicide is the second leading cause of death. That should shock you. It should shock you. We live in a country second best in the world, and our young people are killing themselves. Why? Because hope deferred makes the heart sick. There is a hopeless message that is coming out of the news, and it's not getting any better. It's not getting any better. And so, to the message of Advent. There is a light shining in the darkness, and that light is the message, my friends, of Jesus Christ. We as believers have a hope the world doesn't have. We wait for it. What's it? We wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Do I have to say that again to get an amen? We're waiting for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. When we speak of this thing, the blessed hope, we have to speak also of faith. Hope and faith, they're the same but different. For Scripture gives us, this is the definition of faith. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. So faith and hope are similar concepts, but yet they're also different. The well-known passage in 1 Corinthians 13, of course, is these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. Notice that faith and hope are listed separately. They're similar, but they're different. Now, the message today, I'm going to center on hope, but understanding what hope really is, because this is essential. Faith is complete confidence or trust in something. When you are presented with a set of facts, it needs to involve first our mind. And our mind is going to determine if those facts are true. When we say we have faith in Jesus, we are saying that we completely trust Christ alone for our eternal destiny. Once we give mental assent to those truths, then it needs to affect our heart, and then we are born again. But hope is something that needs to be built on faith. Hope is the earnest expectation that comes with believing a promise that something good is just around the corner. So hope is a constant, natural expectation that will naturally stem from faith. Understand that hope must involve something that hasn't happened yet. You can't hope for something you've got. Right? Don't work. Romans 8:24. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? That is exactly why Jesus is our blessed hope. We wait for the blessed hope. Right now we can't see him. But we know he's coming. We know he's coming. We know he's coming, my friends. It is closer today than it was yesterday. I know that for a fact. And when I think about that, it's what we call joy unspeakable. So it is by faith in the promise of Jesus that causes us to hope what in the fulfillment of his words. Because his words cannot fail. Let's put it like this. Jesus promised that one day we would be with him. Okay? You got me? 1 Corinthians 15:20 says, Jesus is the first fruits of those that have fallen asleep. We believe those words. By faith as a believer in Christ, you believe those words. That Jesus is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. We believe that. That is the basis of our faith. But then we also have a promise in John 14:19 where Jesus said, because I live, you live also. Those words are words of hope. Because we haven't got that yet, it's based on our faith. And because of our faith, we have hope. It's sort of like a young boy that, you know, hears his dad say, son, tomorrow we're going on a camping trip. Going to be real cool. There's going to be fishing and campfires and roasting marshmallows and all that good stuff we do. And the young boy believes he's going camping the next day. He's convinced because his father told him, and he believes his father, so he is going camping. Because because he has a natural trust in the words of the Father. We call that faith. Now, at the same time, the boy is filled with joy because of the things that the Father has planned for him. And he's so excited that he can't even sleep that night. That, my friends, is what we call hope. So faith is grounded in the reality of the past, what has been accomplished, what God has said. But hope looks to the reality of the future. Without faith, there is no hope. That's why we live in a hopeless world, because there is no faith in Christ. It is only if we have faith in Christ that we have any hope. We live in a hopeless world. But brothers and sisters, as Christians, we're just passing through this world. We're just passing through. We are citizens of heaven where the Lord Jesus Christ lives. And we are eagerly awaiting for him to return as our Savior. He will take our weak mortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like his own, using the same power with which he will bring everything under his control. Amen. 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 Yes, God has made a promise. Faith believes it, hope anticipates it, and patience quietly waits for it. That is the divine pattern that you will see from Genesis to Revelation. Faith believes it, hope anticipates it, and patience waits for it. It's coming, folks. It's coming. So the Advent message is a message of hope. See, we can look back 2,000 years to that very first Advent when God became flesh. But our hope is not in what has been. That's faith. We believe that. But our hope is what will be, which is the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. So let's go to the words of the prophet Isaiah. They'll be on the screen at the back. Isaiah 9. I'm just going to read a few verses from here. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. In this scripture, the prophet Isaiah is talking about the nation of Israel and how it has suffered under the hand of the Assyrians. The Assyrians have devastated the land. They've taken captives. They've devastated the countryside. It was a dark time. It was a dismal time. It was a hopeless time when the prophet Isaiah wrote these words. A time without hope. And if you take time to read all of Isaiah 9, you come across words like this: gloom, distressed, oppressed. The people have walked in darkness. All descriptions of people giving up on life, hopelessness. But when Isaiah receives this prophetic word, he looks down 600 years down in the future to a time that God gives him this vision that something is coming. Something is coming. But a new day will dawn while there will be a true light, where joy will be increased, when there shall be deliverance and peace. And of course the question is, as he writes his prophecy, is when? When is this going to happen? But even more important is who? Who is he talking about? Who is going to bring this about? You don't have to go any further than scripture. Matthew 4, 15 and 16, we read this: the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And upon those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, light has dawned. And so these verses make it totally clear that his name is Jesus. Since these are the words of Isaiah, and for 600 years, was what? Hoped for. Verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. We've heard those terms often, but have you thought about them? For unto us a child is born. Well, that's not really much of a promise, because, I mean, that happens all the time. Children are born every day. So it speaks of the humanity of this coming Savior. But unto us a son is given. You thought about that. Unto us a son is given. What does that mean? That's unusual. A son being given. Again, look no further. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that what? He gave his only begotten son. And so we see God giving his son. And so we see the deity of Christ. Even these prophetic words of the prophet, that this coming Savior is going to be totally human, but totally divine. And it's like, well, how is this going to happen? How is this going to happen? And so every Christmas, of course, we call this Emmanuel, right? God with us. And so every Christmas, we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And we celebrate the wonderful news that God did not abandon us to hopelessness, but he sent his one and only Son into this world. True light was coming into the darkness. Let's go back and think about that first Christmas for a year. Because finally, after 600 years after the prophet Isaiah gave these words, they were coming true. What a strange event this was. Let's just go back there for a minute. Just sort of look at it. The herald, right? You send a herald, you know, to announce what's coming. And so the announcer of the Messiah was to be John the Baptist. Now we know the father, Zacharias, he's an old priest, and his wife Elizabeth had prayed for a child for many years. But they were old and past childbearing years. You remember the story how the angel Gabriel comes to Zacharias while he's in the temple, and he foretells the birth of their son, and that he would name him John. But because of their old age, well, Zacharias had a few doubts. And he said, how can this be? I'm an old man, and my wife, well, she's pretty old too, and this just can't happen. Unbelief doesn't seem to work well with God, and Zacharias became mute. He couldn't speak a word until the baby was born, and then on the eighth day, when he was taken to be circumcised, his father, Zacharias, was able to speak. And what did he speak? He said that his name would be called John. And he also prophesied that he would be called the prophet of the highest, that the highest, the Messiah was coming, that he would go before the face of the Lord and prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation from the remission of sins, to give light to those who sat in darkness in the shadow of death, and to guide the feet in the way of peace, and to announce to Judea that the King of Kings was coming. Hope was being stirred. Hope was stirring in the heart of people. Hope that one day, 600 years after the prophecy was given, the preacher said last week, the Messiah is coming. I don't know about this. I don't know about coming. He's coming. Never give up. And so the child grew, became strong. He was in the desert until the day of his manifestation to Israel. And John was the one who would baptize Jesus in the River Jordan. And John was the one that heard the voice from heaven, "You are my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." Well, that is the message that Zechariah heard. And as well for us, don't be afraid. I haven't forgotten your prayers. Don't be afraid. I haven't forgotten your prayers. Don't be afraid. I haven't forgotten your prayers. Well, the angel Gabriel, those days, he was pretty busy. And he was doing another announcement. And he goes to a young teenager in Nazareth, a backwater town in Galilee. And he goes to Mary and he says, Mary, you're going to have a child, and this child is going to be the Son of God, the Son of the Most High God. And the name of this child is going to be Yeshua, in our language, Jesus. Name means Savior. Now, you see, Mary didn't have the same problem Elizabeth had, because Mary was a teenager. wasn't the same problem, but she had another problem. We could say an even bigger problem. She was, of course, a virgin. And not only that, she was engaged to be married. In Jewish culture, that's the same as being married. Now, we have some history, I guess, with, Elizabeth, and we can go back to Abraham and Sarah, and we could see that there's been some miraculous births. But you can search the pages of the Bible, and you won't find another virgin birth. It's just not happened. Just not happened. Mary says to the angel, how will this be, since I'm a virgin? Those weren't words of doubt. Those weren't words of unbelief. I think maybe Mary was just sort of clarifying things, hoping maybe the angel might have got the wrong address or something, but I think she's just clarifying it. Hope you got the facts straight. You do know I'm a virgin. Well, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High God will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Gabriel tells her what is going to happen. Something that has never occurred before and will never occur again. The Son of the Living God was about to come into this fallen, sinful world. And the response of Mary was simply to believe. Yes, she knew it was impossible. But her response was, with God, nothing will be impossible. There you have it. Mary believed. Mary knew, my friends, that no word from God is without power. Do you know that today? No word from God is without power. No word from God is without power. Now let me remind you of this, that God does not change. We might change. Seasons change. But God does not change. He doesn't grow old. He doesn't grow tired. Mary told us that nothing is impossible with God and demonstrated that truth by bringing the God of all creation to this earth in her womb. How possibly could the human womb contain the God of creation? How is it possible? I don't know. I have no idea. I don't think even Mary knew. She just believed it and took God at his word. Why did God choose Mary? That's a fair question, right? After all, she was a nobody. A nobody. And she was totally unworthy of this great honor. And she was right. She was unworthy. Yet Mary, in great humility, believed God. And she knew that God scattered the proud and exalted the lowly. And we know also from Scripture that Mary had a good understanding of the Torah, which is the Old Covenant. Again, we need to get into the Word. But of all people, Mary had this incredible privilege of being the very first person to worship Jesus. She could worship him in her womb because she knew this was the Son of God. And she worshipped him. And God chose her from among the many, among the nobodies. You see, it isn't the letters after your name. It isn't your PhD or your this or that. Those things, they might make a difference with people, but they don't move God. God is moved by faith. God is moved by faith. People that dare to believe that God can do absolutely anything. He used Moses, who had a speech impediment. Gideon, who was the least important kid in the family. David, a little kid who got the job of watching the sheep while his big brothers went off to fight the Philistines. God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. He chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. This gives us hope, my friends, that God will use whosoever will. It's not about us. It's not about our standing. It's not about our education. It's not about our lack of education. It's not about our self-esteem. It's simply not about us, but it's about Christ. Almighty God became flesh. God became a little baby. The awesome power that created the planets, that spoke this universe into being, emptied himself into the womb of a teenager in the town of Nazareth. How is that possible? I don't think even Gabriel knew. All we know, as I said before, friends, is it happened. And even all these centuries later, this miraculous conception remains impossible to understand by human reason. You see, God did not choose to explain it to us. He did not give us the details of how this happened. You see, the real issue is not whether a virgin can conceive. The real issue is anything impossible for God?
No.
No, exactly. The issue isn't, if somebody wants to argue about the virgin birth, let them argue about it. You need to take in the fact, is anything impossible for God?
No.
Nothing is impossible for God. Therefore, end of discussion. Nothing is impossible for God. Mary was the first to confess it. No word from God is without power. The prophet Jeremiah declared, Sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for you. Nothing is too difficult for you. And the remainder of the verses from Isaiah 9 are well known. And the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. You know, when the prophet Isaiah penned those words, as I said, he did not know that there would be not just a one-time coming of this promised Messiah. He didn't understand that his words contained not one coming, but two comings. That this Messiah would come, and then he would leave. But then after a long time, he would come again. Friends, we live in this time of waiting. We don't like to wait, do we? We don't like to wait. We'd like it today. Patience. Never pray for patience. God will make sure you get it. We live in this time of waiting, but the cry of our heart is, we wait for the blessed hope. Now, brothers, when you listen to the news, when people try to discourage you, you fix your eyes on that word. We wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. We just sung about it. It's well with my soul. When the sky is rolled back, and one day it's going to happen, friends, the trump will sound. The trump will sound. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. That is in the Word of God. He's coming. And our hope is in the coming of the Lord. Our hope is in the second advent. And my friends, it says that when Jesus returns to this planet, the government will be upon his shoulder. He won't be liberal. He won't be conservative, Republican, Democratic. It will be under the feet of Jesus. The government will be Jesus Christ. You won't have to vote for him. He will be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He will reign forever. Amen. Amen. Mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, of the increase of his government of peace, there will be no end. No end. No end. From that time forward and forever. And then it says, my friends, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. God himself, his own zeal, is going to perform it. So this Advent season is a season of hope. Light is coming, my friends. Light is coming. Light naturally dispels darkness. When you turn a switch on, you don't have to shoo the darkness out. Once the light comes on, poof, you can see everything. Light is coming. Light is coming. Light is coming. Let me close with this scripture. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. He who testifies to these things, surely I am coming quickly. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Father, I pray, Lord, for those, Lord, in this building, those that are listening over the internet. Lord, if there's any right now that are contemplating suicide or even those things, Lord, God, whatever it is, if there's a sense of hopelessness, if there's a sick heart, whatever it is, wherever it is around this world, I pray that they would consider the words of Scripture. We wait for the blessed hope. Hope is coming. Do not give in. Never, never, never give in. Jesus is coming. The light of the world is coming. And I pray today that that will impact your heart and change your countenance and lift you up. Light is coming. Jesus is coming. Father, I just pray that we would be encouraged and stirred by the Word of God, by your words, because as we said earlier, Lord, no Word of God is without power. Lord, is there anything too difficult for you? Absolutely not. Help us to refocus on these things. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. And amen. So my friends, be encouraged. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. Amen. Anybody would like prayer? If you'd like to receive Christ, that is your greatest need. You might be sick in your body, but friends, your greatest need is Christ. If you've never given your life to Christ, please come and talk to myself, Pastor Glenn. Yield your life to Christ today. He is your light. If you'd like prayer for any reason, please come forward. I'd love to pray with you. Amen. Other than that, have a great week serving Jesus and continue in hope.